welcome to the panel, The Transnational Life of Objects. Loredana Polezzi, Professor of Translation Studies in the School of Modern Languages at Cardiff University. Her main research interests are in the connection between translation, migration, and other forms of travel. Her recent work focuses on how geographical and social mobilities are connected to the theories and practices of translation and self-translation. With Rita Wilson, she is co-editor of The Translator. She is currently a co-investigator in the research project Transnationalizing Modern Languages, funded by the UK's Arts and Humanities Research Council under its Translating Cultures scheme. And she is also a founding member of the Cultural Literacy in Europe Network.
Thank you, and thank you for being still here. It's the last session of the day, so we're all flagging, but hopefully we'll keep you awake. So the three papers that we're going to present today, myself and then Margaret and Carlo, are all indeed part of the Transnationalizing Modern Languages project. They're different facets of the work that we're doing. This is a large project, which has a lifespan of 3 years, and we're just into our third year, and which involves not just the three of us, but more than a dozen people working worldwide. I keep saying the two images I keep using to describe the project are, one, that we're going from the Orkneys to Tasmania, and literally we are, we're covering that far. but also that the project is a bit like the double helix of DNA. We're looking at the mobility of Italian communities and Italian cultures across the world and the transnational nature of that. But in doing that, we're also trying to rethink the way in which we formulate and we teach as well modern languages as disciplines and using Italian and Italian mobility for that. Now today, we're all talking in different ways about objects, about material culture, and in my case, in particular, I want to talk about reframing photographs. I'll get to my case study in a second, but what I want to talk to you about for a minute is the kind of methodological framework of all this. So in the TML project, in this project, what we're trying to ask is what happens if we place mobility at the center of the research and the educational agenda within modern languages and possibly beyond in the humanities. And in TML, we're asking what happens if we see multiple forms of mobility, including migration, translation, and other transnational practices as deeply connected phenomena, involving multiple agencies and engaging both individuals and communities in the creation of complex knowledge, affect, and memory networks. This means, amongst other things, foregrounding the connectedness of different kinds of mobility, as well as of translation, memory work, and material culture. Now, let me start with mobility. Traditionally, forms of human mobility have been understood as separate entities and studied under different disciplines. So you have migration studies on one side, you have translation studies on another side, and so on and so forth. But boundaries are shifting in disciplines as well as in human mobility itself, so much so that a few years ago, Hanan Scherer and Ari identified what they call a mobility turn, spreading into and transforming the social sciences, and I would add the humanities too. As they noted, and I'm quoting them, the concept of mobility encompasses both the large-scale movements of people, objects, capital, and information across the world, and the more local processes of daily transportation, movement through public space, and the travel of material things within everyday life. All of these mobilities are also entangled with linguistic phenomena and form multinodal webs, which are relational and are also performative, and which make little sense if we try to interpret them in terms of traditional, atomized, discipline-bound models and methods. Instead, Tim Cresswell, for instance, has suggested that we should adopt Walter Benjamin's concept of constellation and think of how mobility manifests itself in different forms, coalescing, materializing, literally, into different constellations in different places and at different times, according to different parameters. And he lists particular parameters where I think he gets a bit too taxonomic for me, and I'm not interested in that. But this idea of the constellation, of the coming together at a particular moment and place, moment in time and particular place is really important. Now, let me move briefly to the connection between translation and mobility. It has become almost commonplace in recent years to draw parallels between notions and practices of travel and of translation. The pioneering work of authors such as Susan Basnett or Michael Cronin in the area of translation studies, and Charles Fosdick and Tim Youngs in that of travel writing, has established a transdisciplinary dialogue centering on the question of how narratives represent the interconnection between linguistic and geographic movement or transfer. In my own work, have also repeatedly drawn that link and attempted to analyze how these two sets of practices are related, figuratively, historically, and also socially. More specifically, and I think also symptomatically, given the images, the tropes, the recurring dramatic media shots that dominate public discourse at present, the specific form of travel which goes under the label of migration has been repeatedly linked to translation. Susan Basnett, for instance, opens a recent collection of essays with the following statement: "The 21st century is the great age of translation. Millions more people are moving around the planet than at any time in history. And as those millions move around, taking their own languages with them, they encounter other languages, other cultural frameworks, and other belief systems, hence are compelled, whether consciously or not, to engage in some form of translation." Now, what interests me here, more than the rhetorical gesture, and you can think also of the famous Salman Rushdie statement about we are all translated men, of course, but what interests me here, more than the rhetorical gesture implicit in such broad statements, is an increasing awareness of the pervasiveness of translation, which calls into question assumptions about the homogeneity about homogeneity as the norm for cultural and linguistic identity, in a nutshell, the old one nation, one language, one culture paradigm, as well as, on the other side, the narrowly linguistic and strictly binary nature of translation, a source text, a target text, a source language, a target language, a source culture, a target culture. What happens when we focus on migration and translation is that instead of the homogeneity of cultures and of linguistics as well as more broadly cultural practices, what comes into focus is the complexity of the cultural processes and practices which permeate contexts of social, geographic, and linguistic mobility, as well as their ubiquity. And this means, in turn, exposing and recognizing processes of linguistic and cultural translation and self-translation, including those that have to do with material culture, as the norm, not the exception. What the nexus between mobility and translation points toward is what I call the translational fabric of texts and experiences. And of all places here, after the previous session and all the rest, I'm using that metaphor very, very consciously. You know, la trama e l'ordito, how complex these networks are. Now, two final very quick methodological points before I move on to my case study and to the images I want to show you and to the photographs I want to show you and their reframing. A further connection to be drawn here is the one between geographic and social mobility and between these and translation. Migration, history tells us, has a strong connection with social positioning, though the correlation may turn out to be positive or negative. The migrant may climb the social ladder, but may also and often fall to the bottom of it. More recently, work by Naoki Sakai, Brett Nielsen, Sandro Mezzadra has pointed to the way in which a politics of translation and of mobility in geographical and as well as social sense is linked to the functioning of capital and the management of labor, both manual and intellectual labor. This is another important area of exploration since, as Mezzadra and Sakai have recently noted, and I'm quoting them again, translation can be productive or destructive by inscribing, erasing, or redrawing borders. It is a process, political par excellence, which creates social relations and establishes new modes of discrimination. Far from being conceived of as the other of violence, translation has emerged as a deeply ambivalent concept and practice. Put simply, translation always cuts both ways, at once a mechanism of domination and liberation, clarification and obfuscation, commerce and exploitation, opening up to the other and appropriation. Translation, to further explicate its constitutive relation with the concept and institute of the border, produces both bridges and walls. And if you ask people to draw you a picture of translation, those two images usually come up together. They draw two islands, so the neat borders of cultures, you know, as if they existed in isolation, and a bridge between them. So very ambiguous image. Try it with your students. It almost never fails. So translation can become paradoxically both an instrument of mobility and immobility. It can create borders as well as make them porous, or accentuate perhaps their porosity. Now finally, the last area in which boundaries and porosity, as well as the central role of mobility, have emerged as key concept and methodological tools, and that I want to draw on, is that of memory studies. Here, work on national memory has been increasingly integrated to and superseded by work focusing on the multidimensional nature of memory work. its intergenerational dynamics, or the intricate networkings created by processes of transnational memory, which is the title of a recent volume, by the way, or, to use Astrid Earle's terminology, traveling memory. Now, if I bring all of these perspectives together, what they point towards is the permeability of cultures, the intensely translational fabric of our lives, which is accentuated every time forms of mobility emerge and intersect, and also the fact that a binary model is not enough. The translation keeps moving. It doesn't just take things from one place to the other, but keeps coming and going, or maybe ping-ponging somewhere else. Now, the example that I want to talk about today is indeed a case of multiple movements. Now, let me introduce you to Duilio Peruzzi. Now, this photograph in itself, I could just spend hours picking it apart, taking it apart. You may recognize the kind of landscape. This is a Tuscan landscape, okay? It's taken in Tuscany, it's taken in Tuscany in the 1950s. The guy's on a Vespa, and an icon of the 1950s in Italy. But he looks like James Dean. You know, he's, in a way, he's the model of the American, you know, the T-shirt turned up, the cap, and all the rest. Now, this, so the story I want to tell you about is the story of the Peruzzi family, and in particular of Duilio. Migrant, multiple migrant, friend of my family, and also academic, photographer, and many other things. The Peruzzi family moved from rural Tuscany in the early part of the 20th century to the US. There, the two children, Duilio and his sister, Lina, were born. With the 1929 crash, with the Depression, they came back to Italy, and they went back to the place where they had initially grown up, the parents, to rural Tuscany again. There, Duilio and Lina grew up and studied until the end of the Second World War, when a letter arrived saying they were American citizens, they were born in the US, that they were welcome back, and the family moved back to the US again. Duilio just finished high school there. He was a clever guy. His diploma was not worth much in the US, but he went to night school, and from night school to university, and from university went on to do a PhD at the University of Michigan. And his PhD, he decided to do on the area, he's a social geographer, that was his area of study, and he decided to do his PhD on the area where he had grown up. So he returned to Italy in 1956, got a Vespa, arrived with all his photographic equipment, and went around taking 700 photographs. 700 photographs which were the documentary evidence of a very scientific PhD, entitled Cortona, a valley hill mountain complex of modified Mediterranean agriculture in central Italy. This was completed and awarded in 1962-63. So those photographs were the documentation of that. Now, by the way, I don't doubt that Lina, I have never met Lina. I've only met Duilio. Duilio has been very much part of my life. I've known him all my life. But Lina I've never met. Why? Because Lina came to the States. I don't doubt that she was as intelligent as Duilio, but there's a gender history here as well. Lina married and did not sort of move backwards and forwards a lot. Duilio got an academic job at the University of California, and there, over the years, became one of the people who would regularly be the directors of the University of California program in Florence. So he kept coming back to Tuscany, and every time he would also come and visit the family and visit the friends. He was one of the closest childhood friends of my own father, and my connection with him. At a certain point in that history of continuing mobility, of moving backwards and forwards, where Duilio was perceived, of course, as the Americano in Cortona, but also very much the Italiano at the other end, the local photo club got to hear about the 700 photographs. And so they decided to ask him to put up an exhibition. Now, the photographs got reframed at this point. So what had been a scientific documentation for a PhD in social geography at Michigan University became, in many ways, a celebration of a sort of autho-ethnographic nostalgia in the place where those photographs had been taken. So what happened at that point was that this was created. I have the CD, but this was the poster of the exhibition. So the exhibition was called now Colture e Culture, Immagini e Colori della Vita nella Valdichiana Cortonese. So cultures and cultures, you know, the play on word between agriculture and culture, and then images and colors of life in the Valdichiana area. Now, the interesting thing also is that the place where the exhibition was held is at the top there in the fortress, which is the most prestigious exhibition space in Cortona, which is one of the most prestigious hill towns in Tuscany and you know, has plenty of visibility. And so literally when this photograph was shown in that exhibition, it was literally framed in a room where you then had the window that looked out on that same identical landscape. Now, of course, transformed, because this was 2001, so you're talking about 1956, almost 50 years later. So you're literally seeing those 50 years in counterpoint through the window of this place. Now, the photos were also reframed in other ways. I have intentionally chosen to show you the unframed version, but in the CD, which I can't play you here because it's a bit too complicated, I'm afraid. If you get into the CD, and we're hoping to show this in our media collection on the website and in the exhibition we're going to do, you get three versions of these photographs. You can open up the unframed one, which I've shown you. You can get literally a framed one with a caption in English, and you can get another one framed but with a caption in Italian. And the captions are sometimes the same, but not necessarily always absolutely identical. Starting with, if I go back to Duilio, so this in Italian is captioned L'autore e la sua GS, you know, his GS. I mean, this is the Vespa as Italians would know it. And then in English it becomes the author with his scooter, which I find a little bit. Okay. But you can see the play, you know, there's a lot of play, and also a lot of play on what he needs to say and what he doesn't need to say. And this, the titles were a collaboration. He was mostly doing this, but it was a collaboration with the local photo club, with friends in the local photo club. So there's clearly a negotiation about what the audience needs to know in English, in Italian. Now, keep in mind that Cortona has a very international tourist audience. It's one of the places which draw the most tourists. Cortona at this point had already been also the object, of course, of Francis Mayer's Under the Tuscan Sun, one of the most successful travelogues of the last whatever many years. And so, and by the way, she taught at the same university as Duilio. I have a copy that Duilio got me signed by Francis Mayer because they were friends. And he got very upset. Where's Joe? And the question about, you know, whether we speak Italian, who speaks Italian correctly. Duilio was reprimanding Francis for not spelling the Italian correctly in her book, but she never bothered to have it checked by him, which is something that was really interesting in many ways, again, about what we think. Now, a couple more pictures that I want to show you. He's a great photographer, by the way. So these photographs are not just documents. They are aesthetically incredibly interesting. But he's capturing a lot of moments, clearly. And these are a selection of the 700, about 200 were, which is a huge amount, but about 200 were selected for the CD and the exhibition. So obviously, they've been selected in certain ways and have been arranged into chapters, so landscapes, local celebrations, interior scenes. So they become really a function of the local memory, but filtered through the eye of someone who was both an outsider and an insider, and reframed from the scientific document now into this different kind of document. Let me show you. There's also, you know, things that I suppose by now even people in the area would no longer be familiar with, such as the killing of the pig and then the curing, the treating of the pig. So this is captioned in Italian and in English. It's captioned burning of the hair and washing with hot water, or viene tolto il pelo tramite bruciatura e acqua bollente. Again, the very narrative description of what is happening here. But this is something that is by now in need of explanation, both for the Italian community and for the American community, because it's now unfamiliar to both. And this one I want to show you because, of course, when I then saw this, well, in this, there's half of my family. So there's my mother there in the green jumper, there's my grandmother in black on the side, there's a couple of my uncles scattered in there. Now, this is interesting because at the time I was writing indeed a piece on Francis Mayer's book saying, which is called Did Someone Just Travel All Over Me? I'm a travel writing specialist. How do I approach something that talks about my own place? And so when I then got back to this, to these photographs, I'm very conscious of my own reframing, of course, now of this work, and of the fact that I am reframing these photographs yet again, bringing them back, in a way, into an academic context and into a form of critical analysis, out of which they had been partly taken through that nostalgic operation of reading them as a local documentation. But I'm also taking them back somewhere else. So this is to give you some sense of the complications that these kinds of movements may entail. And the last thing I will say is that, again, as I was saying, that there are issues here which have to do with social structures, with the workings of collective as well as individual memory, with affect networks. I went to San Francisco a couple of weeks ago, and I was hoping to interview Duilio. He's now 90, unlikely to come back to Italy again. But he felt too emotional to actually talk about these things. And so as a researcher, you're then also asking yourself to what extent. So he's very happy for me, for us to use this material, but at the same time, for him, this has become, again, he has now reframed it as a document of his own youth, which brings tears to his eyes, literally. And what he said to me is, I can't see you because I think of your father. Which of course then brings tears to my eyes, but it's a complex relationship again of affect, of which as researchers we are not, you know, to which we are not immune, clearly. So what I've been trying to show you very, very quickly, and I promise you the photographs are stunning, by the way. What I hope to have shown you through these theoretical meanderings and also some examples of creative reframing is how the memory of mobility is constituted as a complex network of translational acts. Physical translation and linguistic translation and visual translation in many ways. In studying new and old Italian migrations, or any other migration histories for that matter, those networks, their constellations, their serendipity and their tragic or dramatic personal moments need to be carefully followed and reconstructed in ways that underline and accentuate the permeability and inclusivity of cultural practices. The construction of the memory of mobility is in itself a complex translation process which involves local and global acts of creation and making and remaking, framing and reframing of objects and narratives. Affect is an important factor in the production, archiving and dissemination of memory, just as gender, economic power and social status are. Systematizing these processes is extremely difficult, but Benjaminian constellations with their associations to notions of fragment, mosaic, collage, montage, and their warning against any temptation presented by linear teleological visions of history and of progress can indeed help us, I think, to catch important and only apparent serendipitous connections, such as those that emerge from the individual and collective reframing of photography. The other question that is raised by this kind of work, of course, is how do we construct an archive that is capable of testifying and showing rather than hiding these reframings? And I think Carlo and Margaret will talk more about that.